Hello, brothers and sisters in the Lord. How are you? We all locked in. I want to share with you this. The more I read and study this wonderful book, the King James Bible, the more I am absolutely fascinated for treasure of wisdom, the amount of information that is here in this book, King James Bible. King James Bible, ciao Graciela, is made up of 66 books from Genesis to Revelation. And interesting enough, there is a book in the 66 books, the book of Isaiah, which means the Lord is salvation, which is made up of 66 chapters. And it's got a division similar to Old Testament, New Testament, like amazing. Now, all the Bible is for us. We know that, Paul tells us, all scripture is inspired, which means God breathed, and is profitable for doctrine, correction. But not all scripture is directly to us and about us. Why? Because from the very beginning of the book, in the book of Genesis, we read that in the beginning, can't define exactly where, but in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. So straight away, we see two realms in creation, the heaven and the earth. And in the prophetic program, we learn the plan of God, the program for the earth, where the Lord creates Himself, creates, ciao Paul, the nation of Israel. Imagine, even in the name Israel, El, God, she means prince with God. And through this nation, God will regain actually, the earth. You say, why regain? Because there's been a rebellion. There's been rebellion actually in heaven and earth, in the heaven and the earth. But whoever goes in rebellion against the Lord is, what, mad? Nutter, crazy, I don't know. God is the Almighty God, so there is no way in the world that anyone, anywhere, even an angelic being, even a very powerful angelic being, can even think to succeed in the rebellion. Because creatures are not like the Creator. The Creator is the Almighty God. Anyway, as I was saying, there is a program for the earth, so there is a prophetic program, and you see the history of Israel from the very beginning, you know, with the creation of the nation, the call of Abraham, which becomes Abraham. So you have Abraham, then you get Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, then you have Moses, and then, of course, you got the law, you know, and then the temple, the sacrifices, the Levites, and everything in the law. And then you have, of course, the prophets. So you have the law, the prophets, and then, of course, you have the first coming, the first coming of the Lord Jesus Christ to his earthly people, Israel. And he said very clearly, even though unfortunately the great majority of Christianity maybe doesn't know, maybe doesn't want to know, I don't know, but in Matthew 15, in verse 24, the Lord Jesus Christ defines his ministry on earth, because he said, but I'm not sent, but he answered and said, Matthew 15:24, I'm not sent but unto the lordship of the house of Israel. So the four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, which we can also define the red letters, are written to and about the ministry, the earthly ministry of Christ to Israel, specifically to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. So you will not find the gospel that saves you and the doctrine that saves you, or the doctrine that you got to follow, in the four Gospels. Impossible. Actually, if you try, you dig a big hole under your feet, you will fall into it, and that's terrible. As I said, also, Paul explains that Jesus was a minister of God, you know, of the circumcision, to confirm the promises that God made to the nations of Israel. So that's the first coming. Then it's going to be a second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ to and about the nation of Israel on earth. So the second coming is not to the body of Christ. I know the body of Christ is sometimes, you know, slogan, Jesus is coming, Jesus is coming. We make fun of ourselves. We look ridiculous because it's 2,000 years that Christians have said, Jesus is coming, Jesus is coming. And people laugh and mock and say, come on, you know. It's 2,000 years, what are you talking about? And actually, the great damage done by the date setters, ooh. If you study that, you can study that in the history of the religion, church, you will find that from the very first century, there's been people that Jesus Christ is coming, the end is here, around the corner, now, you know. And so they give you dates which, as you can understand, as you can verify, fail miserably, also because that's not something that God wants. But people like to do what God doesn't want them to do. That's the nature of the flesh, you know, the nature of man. Even now, you know, because there is the COVID-19, coronavirus, whatever, boom, blah, blah, pandemic, whatever, palademic, whatever it is. Palademic, that's a new thing. Pala is a ball you can play with. Everybody says, this is the end, this is the end. No, this is the end of life as we have been living until now. That's not the end of the world. That's another study, but the end of the world, they see at least 1,007 years away from us, imagine. Now, the body of Christ is the other program, is the heavenly program, because remember I told you at the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth, so all the story, the earth you find in the prophetic program. So you would say from Genesis all the way to the book of Acts chapter 8 is all prophetic program. Imagine the red letters are Old Testament books, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, because Paul explains, you know, the scripture explains actually that the Testament in the book of Hebrews, so it's not Paul, sorry, I apologize. A Testament is not valid until there is the death of the testator, and Jesus, we know, he dies at the end of the four Gospels. So whatever you read before is all the law. Jesus was under the law. He was preaching and reinforcing the law to his people that were under covenant, under the law. Anyway, then there is a program, which is heavenly program. So it's the heavenly ministry of Christ. Christ from heaven, revealing to the new apostle Paul, revealing the glorious revelation of the mystery in this, the dispensation of the grace of God. So then you have 13 letters to the new creature, the body of Christ, Romans to Philemon, and this is just a way to sum up everything. And there is practically the revelation of the mystery, which was hidden God for ages and generations, but now it's been revealed. So now, if you really want to follow the Lord, by following Paul to follow Christ, we have to preach Christ according to the revelation of the mystery, not according to the red letters or the prophetic program. So all these people now, they say the end, and they say, and they quote Psalm 91, you know, that's your protection. Other people say, if we pray, God is not going to do anything. I tell you now, prepare you now. You can pray until you blue in the face. God is not intervening because it's not the time of his intervention in the affairs of man. We are in the dispensation of grace since Acts 9. God is silent in terms of he's not saying anything new. I don't care that the Pope in Rome hears something or some pastor, word of faith, Pentecostal. God speaks through his book. So it's your responsibility as mine, as well, my responsibility to go and read and study so we know what God is doing and why. So, as I said before, in Romans 16, verse 25, it says, now to him that is of power to establish you. You want to be established? Initially you get established and then at the end established. According to my gospel. So you got to follow the gospel of Paul, not the gospel of John 3:16. And the preaching of Jesus Christ according to the revelation of the mystery. Did you understand that? Which was kept secret since the world began, but now is made manifest. And by the scripture of the prophets, to the commandment of the everlasting God, made known unto to all nations, or the Gentiles, to all nations, for the obedience of faith. No obedience to the law, nobody can obey the law, but faith. So, let's clarify this. Mirax, right division, is not a denomination. Alright? So don't say, I belong to the denomination of right divide. It doesn't exist. Mid-Ax means we start mid-Ax more or less chapter 9 where Paul gets saved and we study the word of truth, which is the Bible, all of it, rightly dividing truth from truth. And we follow Paul to follow Christ. And we have one Bible, not 50, 100, 300 version per version, the King James Bible, which is infallible, inerrant, inspired, because it's God-breathed, and preserved. Oh, I don't like that. Well, you're responsible with God, you know, because four times he says in his word, do not change my word, do not add, do not diminish, because the consequences here and in eternity are quite serious. You and I, we don't like it if somebody changes our own word, right? If I say something serious, and then somebody reports whatever I said in a different way, I wouldn't like it. I got to go and fix, you know? Imagine how God feels when we start to tampering, playing with his word, changing it. Oh, this in Greek means, in Hebrew means, changing the meaning of what is clearly written. That's terrible. Don't do it. Don't do it. Now to him that is a power to establish you according to my gospel, that's the Apostle Paul writing the book of Romans chapter 16 verse 25, and the preaching of Jesus Christ. So we preach Jesus Christ according to the revelation of the mystery, which was kept secret since the world began. The beginning God created the heaven and the earth, starts the prophetic program. But you don't hear anything about the mystery. If Satan, the one who started the rebellion, would know the revelation of the mystery, he would know the mystery, he would not have crucified the Lord of glory. Because by the crucifixion of Christ, Almighty God saves a miserable, ungodly, sinner, enemy of God like me and you, on the basis of what Christ has accomplished. He died for our sins, according to the scriptures. He was buried. He rose again the third day for our justification, according to the scriptures. So, you have no part whatsoever in your salvation, but simply believing what God has accomplished, by the death, burial, resurrection. We say DBR, death, burial, resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. No an angel, no an archangel, the Lord God, true man and true God. Okay, so this was an introduction. Let's go to this wonderful, wonderful book, the Epistle of Paul, the Apostle to the Ephesians. Because, as I said, the Lord inspired Paul to write 13 letters, Romans to Philemon, in which there is a progressive revelation. So God reveals progressively to Paul all that information that will make is the body of doctrine, which is Pauline doctrine, we call it, in which we see that what God has prepared for us, the body of Christ, the new creature, is totally, completely different from whatever is done in the past or will do in the future with this earthly nation, the nation of Israel. Let's go. Chapter 1. Okay. Chapter 1, Ephesians. King James Bible. Paul. I like it. Every time he says, who's talking? Paul. You should ask yourself, who's talking here? Paul. It's not Peter. Okay. Oh, it's not Jesus in the red letters. Okay. It's not Elijah. I mean, these people, they're very important, but this is Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ, by the will of God. So Paul is not that one morning, you know, the guy was Saul, actually, Saul of Tarsus. He was the enemy of the Lord Jesus and the little flock. He was a Pharisee of Pharisees. He was of the tribe of Benjamin, a Jew of Jews, Hebrew of Hebrews. He profited in his father's religion. A lot. He was very important. He's a member of the Sanhedrin, whatever, you know. I mean, this guy, you know, he was the enemy. And, of course, the grace of God is immense. God saves him on the way to Damascus in Acts 9. I can see that many people come, and as soon as they start to hear this, they run away. Okay. Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ, by the will of God. So, he is not an apostle because, as I said, one morning he woke up and said, I want to be an apostle of Jesus Christ now. You kidding me? He wanted to wipe off the face of the earth the name of Jesus because he thought he was a false prophet. And, you know, his followers, the disciples, the little flock, but yeah, the big meeting on the way to Damascus. Damascus in Syria, you know, the way to Damascus. In Acts 9, they changed his life and the course of history, and that's why you and I can be saved. An apostle of Jesus Christ. What does the apostle word mean? Because, you know, nowadays, especially, I don't know, I got almost 5,000 people that I ask, they ask to befriend. Okay, come. After a while, they go away or continue. I hope they continue in the doctrine, not with me. They got these pastors, they're prophets, apostles, reverends. Give it up. There are no apostles, no prophets in this dispensation of grace. There were 12 apostles, Peter, James, John, Nathaniel, Bartholomew, blah, you know, Andrew, for the 12 tribes of Israel, for the earthly program, for Israel, of the past and the future. With Jesus being the great apostle, the great shepherd, the high priest of that faith. All right, so, and then there is one apostle for the body of Christ. But then there are new apostles with him, you know, Timotheus, Titus. So, there are differences, and things which are different are not the same. For an apostle, Jesus Christ, by the will of God, is writing to the saints, which are at Ephesus, and to the faithful in Christ Jesus. Now, because we live in a world which is absolutely polluted by lies and deception of religion as well, politics and finance, look what they're doing. When you hear the word saint, straight away you imagine somebody like this, look. With the eyes rolled, the hands over with this very long beard, crosses, you know, caps, No. Saints here are alive people. The Ephesians are called saints because saint means you belong to, you are set apart, you belong to the Lord. So the moment you are saved and sealed by grace through faith, no works whatsoever, having believed the glorious gospel, the grace of God in Christ, God declares you to be a saint. Even though you might not very much be a saint every day, in the eyes of God, now you're a saint. Because it's written, not because I say so. I got no authority. I'm preaching from this book. You better do the same. To the saints which are at Ephesus. Ephesus, the city there. And to the faithful in Christ Jesus. Now, faithful, English very easy, full of faith. People that got faith, they're but what? Because people say, I got faith. Yeah, in what? In Batman, Superman, Santa Claus. Grace and peace, sister. In the Lord Jesus Christ. So these people are saints, faithful, men and women, of course, in Christ Jesus, in Christ Jesus. Now, the beautiful thing of this glorious doctrine is a dual operation. When the Lord saves you, he takes you out of Adam and puts you into Christ. So, Christ in you, the hope of glory. Praise be to God. But then, you also are in Christ Jesus. Now, there were people that were in Christ Jesus before Paul and before the body of Christ. And they were in Christ Jesus, in Israel, the believers, the little flock, according to prophecy. But this is according to the revelation of the mystery. Wow, Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ, by the will of God, to the saints which are at Ephesus, and to the faithful in Christ Jesus. Wrath be to you, war and destruction. No, just kidding. Grace be to you, and peace. From God our Father, and from the Lord Jesus Christ. How can God all of a sudden say grace and peace to you, Ephesians? Or me, that I'm in Fremantle, Western Australia, or you that are in South Africa, or North Africa, USA, China, wherever. How can he say that? Because Romans 5 says, therefore, being justified, remember, made just by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. In the Godhead for us, Jesus Christ, the one in the middle, God the Father, the Word, Jesus Christ, and the Holy Ghost, the one in the middle is our Savior, the mediator between God and man. He's the one who went to the cross. He died on that cross, the death of malefactor, and now we know that by the cross of Christ, we are saved. Woo! And sealed forever. Hallelujah! I want to really scream. Forever, nothing can change that. You know, people are so fearful. I got to persevere because, you know, the pastors in the churches, persevere to the end, because they take the stuff they written to Israel under, not only during the Great Tribulation, they got to persevere to the end in that great Jacob's trouble week in the future, while the Antichrist, the false prophet, Satan is persecuting them and everything. It's not, and anyway, it's not even talking about salvation in terms of spiritual terms, but who shall be saved will pass through this Great Tribulation. And they put this tremendous burden on people, and these people say, how in the world can I persevere to the end and fail? So, okay, don't worry, when you fail, there is a bar soap, confess your sins. And so they put all the responsibility of your salvation on you, which is satanic. What? Yes, it's satanic. Yes, it's satanic for a simple reason. You can't save yourself. You couldn't save yourself before. You can't save now. You wouldn't be able to save yourself ever. And it's proud and boastful because all of a sudden, if I pray long enough, if I confess all my sins, If I fast and pray, if I pay tithes, if I'm kind when the little lady wants to cross the road and instead of pushing her under the car, I'll help her to cross the road. So I was just kidding. God is going to save me. Wrong. Nobody. You can't save yourself. I can't save myself. Nobody can. That's the work of God, the operation of God. Aren't you glad? Yeah, but God wants, I gave my life to Jesus. Really interesting. Why? What is it? Well, what about the fact that Jesus gave his life to save your soul? I didn't say anything else. You want to exchange that? Do you want to be really follower of Satan, Lucifer? I will. Five times. You can read in Isaiah 14. I will ascend to the mount. I will go to the... Calm down, relax. Remember this. All have sinned. Start with me, I'm talking. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God, being justified freely by the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. Is that clear? Oh, yes, it is. Grace be to you and peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. I need this now. I need it every day. You need it too. Especially now. You turn on the TV, you're gonna die. Coronavirus is gonna take you. Well, who cares? I got to die. One way or another, I'm gonna die. But the question is, am I saved? So, when this life is over, where am I gonna be? Eh? In the lake of fire? That's not funny, you know. Lake of fire is forever, everlasting. Oh, of course, people don't believe in hell and the lake of fire, but I don't care. It's written here, so I do believe it. Or am I gonna be in heavenly places with Christ? I wanna be there. All right, people say, what have you done to be there? Presumptuous, boastful. Wait a second, I didn't say I saved myself. I said that Jesus saved me and sealed me with the Holy Spirit of promise. It's written here in Ephesians 1:13, and we're gonna go there. So, I can't save myself. I tried. Oh, if I tried, man, you know. And guess what? I tried and I failed. I tried and I failed. And I failed and I tried. And I failed, failed. Confess. Every time I would confess my sins, I would be at least 2 hours. And then when I get up, I say, what about if I forgot some? Of course I did. Especially with age, you forget a lot. So what's going to happen? Well, because sins need to be forgotten, forgiven, all of them, you know. One sin unforgiven, you finished. Christ did it all. Just relax. Take all this religion, learn Paul, and take the religion in a big, put it all together. Ism, all the ism, the denominationalism, but bro, pastor, pro, shh. Take it all, put in the dustbin, put on fire and go with Paul. It's good. Grace be to you and peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. And then in verse 3, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. Now that's amazing stuff. Remember, in the beginning God created the heaven and the earth. He never said this to Israel. No Jew, no Israeli would even imagine. Yeah, I love all the scripture that the sisters are putting. That somebody will go in heaven with God. They're all waiting for Christ came. The kingdom of heaven is the kingdom of heaven coming down to earth. Men try to go to heavenly places before with the Tower of Babel. You know, they start to build this tower to go to heaven. And God says, nah, not good. Let's go down. confuse the languages, and so, pass me a brick, normally, you know, pass me a brick. You know, after all, they couldn't understand each other. And so the construction of the tower, because the Lord had reserved the heavenly places for the mystery creature, the revelation of the mystery, which is the body of Christ. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us. This is a past tense operation, it's a done deal. Yes? With what? With all spiritual blessings, plural, notice, in heavenly places in Christ. I don't know how much I can do tonight, but this is so exciting. Okay. Whew, I'm getting excited. But really, I do. Grace be to you, peace from God, the Father and Lord Jesus Christ. Blessed be the God and Father, the God, Holy Ghost, and Father, God the Father, of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Son, the Word. You see, the God that is present in every scripture, who has blessed us. When? With all spiritual, no earthly. So, the prosperity guru, you know, Copeland, Crawford Dollar, with that name, you know. Tiny, give me your money. Oh, you know, Copeland said that even though there is a coronavirus and churches are closed, you still got to tithe. Because, you know, poor man, he's got just $1 billion, you know. You got to understand, he's poor. Blessed be the God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us, the body of Christ, with all, means all, spiritual, blessings, plural, blessings. Where? In heavenly places in Christ. Brothers and sisters and friends, this is massive. Here we are freaking out. Have I got to take this or that, or this, or put this in the nose, put this in the ear, you know. Temperature. Ah, I'm dead, you know. Okay, we obey the law because we are no rebels. I stay at home, you know, I got to stay at home. And so all the family, me and my wife, stay at home, you know. And everything is fine. Got to respect the law, you know. I don't care really about this present evil world. The God of this world is Satan. Can you imagine? Couldn't care less. Why should I worry, really? Every year I get something, you know. When I know that if I live present, you know, absent aspect, present in the body, absent from the Lord. Absent from the body, present with the Lord, which is far better. Paul said it's far better to be with Jesus. I don't believe that. That's your problem. He goes, I don't believe. You don't believe. Unbelief is a bad thing. You got to believe the Lord and His Word. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. Let's see. Well, what about salvation? Just to start. That's a spiritual blessing. Because you really can't see it. It's not a question that the moment you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, is death, burial, resurrection, a packet falls on, and now you open salvation, bing! No. It's by faith. We walk by faith and not by sight. Faith in His Word. You can't feel it. Can't touch it, you can't smell it, you can't hear it, you can't touch it. Did I say all of them? You can't taste it. Yeah, five senses. These are the five windows which our physical body communicates with this present evil world. But there is the Spirit. So there is a testimony of the Spirit through the Scripture. Our Spirit gets, you know, quicken. We were dead in trespasses and sins. Past operation, you know. And wow, all of a sudden you understand this. You say, wow, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Well, blessed with the... So, salvation, okay. Okay, I am accepted in the beloved. If we're going to read this. We are blessed with all spiritual blessing in heavenly places. Complete in Christ. see, D, delivered from this present evil world and the power of darkness. C, complete in Christ. No, I already said that. My alphabet, A, B, C, D, E, elected. Everyone who's believed, a part of the elected, the body of Christ is elected, Christ is elected. And E, F, forgiven. G. Given, also, oh, no, yeah. We'll see. I got a lot of stuff here, but I can't do all of it. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. According, once again, this guitar comes along, the guitar of the Holy Ghost. Din, 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 din. As he had chosen us in him, praise God. When? Before the foundation of the world. I told you, you can't find it here. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth, Genesis 1:1, and the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God. That's great stuff. I love it. And you know that I believe that the earth is a plane under the firmament. But the point of the matter is, I go on, and read in all these wonderful prophets, you know, that I can't find this. Then I go to Jesus, I can't find it. Then I go to Peter, James, and John. Can't find the first and second Peter, third, first, second, third John, James. Oh, without one, you know, really. Without faith. Faith without works is. No. And then you go to Hebrews. Oh, well, that's written to Hebrews. And then you go to Jude. Man, that's a great book by Small. Nine verses, I think it is. Then you go to Revelation. Fireworks, it's Satan, Antichrist. It's not there. But here it is. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ, according as he hath chosen in him. He's the chosen one. You understand now? We're not Calvinists. Sorry, John Calvin. Yeah, he killed a lot of people, you know. He killed a lot of people that didn't agree with him. So, you know. We're not Calvinists. We don't follow Calvin, we don't follow Arminius. Who's the Arminius? Arminius is the one who said, you got to persevere to the end, yeah. Most Pentecostal and Word of Faith are Arminius followers. Also Calvinists, even among grace believers, unfortunately there are some Calvinists. But I am not, I know you aren't. According to chosen in him before the foundation of the world. We weren't even there, you know. Besides the fact we weren't nowhere in the Bible. Can you imagine before the before he created the heaven and the earth, already had this wonderful program to say good for nothing like me and you, and make the body of Christ, the new creature, that would serve him in heavenly places. Wow. That we should, please notice, be holy and without blame before him in love. Now, this holy means set apart, once again, like saints, you know, and without blame before him in love. You can be sure about that because you're in Christ. Christ cannot be blamed. He's God. And he's giving you, imputing his righteousness. God imputes to you the righteousness of Christ when you believe this gospel. You know, double jeopardy? If God has imputed all the sins to Christ and his righteousness to you on the basis of what he's done and you're believing, you know what? Thank you very much, Palm Sunday, brother. Happy, you know, Palm Sunday. I like, olive. You like olive oil? Sorry, I'm silly. We don't follow Palm Sunday, olive oil. According to chosen in him, before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy without blame before him in love. Double jeopardy. Once Christ has been. Our sins, all the sins. 2 Corinthians 5. Oh. 2 Corinthians 5. Now, because people say, why in the world he gets this stuff? Here. Verse 18 and 19. Okay. And all things are of God, who has reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ, and has given to us the ministry of reconciliation, to which the God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them. Why? Because Christ was receiving that and has committed unto us the word of reconciliation. Now then, we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God did beseech you by us. We pray you in Christ's stead, because he's in heaven at the right hand of the Father. Be ye reconciled to God. And now listen, verse 21. For he, God the Father, has made him, that's the Lord Jesus Christ, to be sin for us, who knew no sin. You know, people go around and say, maybe Jesus sinned. That we might be made the righteousness of God in him. The exchange is massive. I just say happy Sunday, happy Monday, happy Tuesday, happy every day with Christ. So at this point, according as chosen in him, before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love. That's amazing stuff. I cannot even conceive, knowing myself, and God knows me better than I know myself, of course. I can't even conceive it. How can I stand in the presence of Almighty God without blame, holy, in love, the love of the Spirit? It's because of Christ, that's why. Silly me! It's not because of me! It's because of Christ, the true man, the man from heaven. The old Adam is gone. You know what I mean? We'll see this. There's so much, brothers and sisters, having predestinated us. Now, once again, the Calvinists, you see, they think, those poor souls, that God has chosen or predestinated before creation, before you're born, who's going to go to heaven, who's going to go to hell? If this is the truth, I would be very, very, very scared. You never know if it's chosen you for hell or for heaven. And also, it sounds very devilish. And I can't find any threat of the devil in my glorious Lord. So I would say, Calvin, thank God he's dead, Calvin. And the Calvinists, fix this problem. Stop being a Calvinist. Be a King James Bible believer, Pauline dispensational right divider. So he's got a destiny in advance for the body of Christ, unto the adoption of children by Jesus Christ to himself. That's love. This is the love of God, you know. Praise God. According, I told you, this is the guitar of the Holy Ghost. Ding, 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 ding. Or the piano, depends. To the good pleasure of his will. Don't you want to kiss his hand? Lord, bless you. I mean, this is very silly. But the point is, it's amazing. People sing Amazing Grace. This is more than Amazing Grace. The good pleasure of his will. So it was his good pleasure to save a good for nothing like me. Wow. I'm blown away. And that's exactly what happens when you come to understand a little bit more, a bit more. Don't be scared if at the beginning it seems difficult. It's not. A bit more of God and his operation through Christ, because of Christ, by the power of the gospel of Christ, which is the power of God unto salvation, for everyone who believes, to the Jew first and also the Greek, is amazing. Having predestinated us unto adoption of children, we were really children of the devil, you know, in Ephesians, children of wrath, children of disobedience. And now, praise God, yes, we are children of God, adopted by Jesus Christ to himself, according to the good pleasure of his will, to the praise of the glory of his grace. Of course, at this point, man, what do you want to praise? Me, the Pope in Rome, and the Apostle there? Come on. To the praise of the glory of his grace, wherein he has made us, the body of Christ, every single believer and the body of Christ, accepted in the beloved. Verse 7, in whom we have redemption through his blood. Get it, please. The blood. Not the water of the baptistry, not the confession, your confession of sins, not you repenting and confessing sins. That's not. Repenting means change your mind. Not you starting to be a good boy, a good girl, because you can't, you're never really good, and you know. Anyway. No, you going to church every Sunday. Now you can't even go there closely. See? Aha! Big test now. We are the church, the body of Christ. So, where is the problem? In reality, it's the blood. In whom we are redemption, bought back. We've been bought back. We are bought up, bought back through his blood. So, but what does it mean? That's the blood of Christ. It's the blood of God. That's the highest possible price that God accepted for you and me to become his children. And with that comes the forgiveness of sins, please note it, the forgiveness of sins, plural, the forgiveness of sins, not sin, sins, not sin, plural, sins, according to the riches of his grace. Colossians. Colossians 1:14, in whom we are redemption through his blood, even the forgiveness of sins. This is Colossians 1:14. That was Ephesians 1:7. And then Colossians again, chapter 2, verse 13. And you being dead in your sins and the uncircumcision of your flesh, as he quickened together with him, and being forgiven you all trespasses, plural. Alright? Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. Ciao ragazzi, friends, brothers and sisters, keep well, don't be afraid from this virus. You want to wash your hands? You should wash your hands anyway. Wash your hands. Sanitize. Want to put the mask? A carnival now, it's almost carnival, you can do that. But the point of the matter is, don't be afraid. Don't let this system put you to a point of fear, despair, sense of trust in this glorious word, in the Lord. And even if you get sick and die, well, you're going to die anyway. You go to heavenly place if you are saved, okay? So make sure that you have believed exclusively the glorious gospel of grace of God, how Christ died for our sins. He was buried, rose again third day for our justification. The moment you do, God sees that you do. You don't need to say a prayer. Don't do. Don't say, I confess. Don't say anything. Don't add works of any type. Pray as a labor. Just trust, receive, and believe. God sees that. You're saved and sealed. And if I don't see you, I see you in heaven. Grace and peace to all. Ciao, Adriano. Ciao.